Hachette Audio presents Russian Roulette, the inside story of Putin's war on America and the election of Donald Trump. Written by Michael Isikoff and David Korn. Read by Peter Ganim. Introduction. It's a shakedown. Donald Trump was about to explode. It was the afternoon of January 6th, 2017, and for 2 hours, the president-elect had sat in a cavernous conference room at Trump Tower and listened to the leaders of the U.S. intelligence community brief him on an extraordinary document, a report their agencies had produced concluding that the Russian government had mounted a massive covert influence campaign aimed at disrupting the country's political system and electing him President of the United States. Trump had controlled his anger during this meeting, at times raising questions, expressing doubts, and clinging to the idea that it might all be a lie, part of some deep state plot to taint his defeat of Hillary Clinton the previous November and undermine his authority as president. When the spy chiefs, Director of National Intelligence James Clapper, CIA Director John Brennan, and National Security Agency Director Admiral Michael Rogers left the room, one of them stayed behind. FBI Director James Comey then handed Trump something else. It was a two-page synopsis of reports prepared by a former British spy, alleging that Trump and his campaign had actively collaborated with Moscow. The memos claimed Russian intelligence had collected compromising material on Trump that could be used to blackmail him, including a tape of him engaging in sordid behavior with prostitutes in a Moscow hotel room. The FBI was not giving him this information because it believed the reports, Comey explained to Trump. In fact, the Bureau hadn't confirmed any of the sordid details, and Comey told him that he was not personally under investigation. But the material was circulating within the media and might become public. The intelligence community, Comey said, merely wanted to provide him a heads up. When Comey left, Trump was incensed. "It's bullshit," he told his aides. None of this was true. The discussion turned to why Comey had gone through this exercise. Suddenly, it all made sense to Trump. He knew exactly what this was. "It's a shakedown," Trump exclaimed. They were blackmailing him. Comey, no doubt with the approval of the others, was trying to send him a message. They had something on him. Trump had seen this sort of thing before. Certainly his old mentor Roy Cohn, the notorious fixer for mobsters and crooked pals, knew how this worked. So too did Comey's most famous predecessor, J. Edgar Hoover, who had quietly let it be known to politicians and celebrities that he possessed information that could destroy their careers in a New York minute. Now, as Trump saw it, Comey and the rest were trying to do this to him. But he was not about to let them. Trump's anger that day helped set the tone for one of the most tumultuous presidencies in American history. His first year in office would be filled with fits of rage at his political enemies, bizarre early morning tweet storms, and repeated denunciations of the purveyors of fake news who challenged his honesty, his competency, and even his mental stability. Much of this turmoil related to the relentless investigations of Russia's attack on the 2016 election, a subject that infuriated Trump more than anything else. Russia had become a rallying cry for his tormentors, the original sin of his presidency, a scandal that raised questions about both his legitimacy and the nation's vulnerability to covert information warfare. Yet Trump defiantly refused to acknowledge Russia's extensive assault as a real and significant event. In his mind, any inquiry into the matter was nothing but an effort to destroy him. The Russia scandal, though, dated back decades. For years, Trump had pursued business deals in Russia, continuing to do so even through the first months of his presidential campaign. And this colored how he would engage with the autocratic, repressive, and dangerous Russian leader, Vladimir Putin. The Trump-Russia tale was rooted in the larger post-Cold War geopolitical clash between the United States and Russia, a conflict that Moscow in 2016 shifted into the cyber shadows to gain a strategic advantage. With Trump unable or unwilling to come to terms with Putin's war on American democracy, it fell to government investigators and reporters to piece together the complete story, an endeavor that could take years to complete. This book is a first step toward that. No matter how Trump regarded the scandal, one thing was for certain. To prevent a future attack, the American public and its leaders had to know and face what had occurred. A thorough accounting was a national necessity. Chapter 1. Mr. Putin would like to meet Mr. Trump. It was late in the afternoon of November 9, 2013, in Moscow, and Donald Trump was getting anxious. This was his second day in the Russian capital, and the brash businessman and reality TV star was running through a whirlwind schedule to promote that evening's extravaganza at Moscow's Crocus Hall, the Miss Universe pageant, in which women from 86 countries would be judged before a worldwide television audience estimated at 1 billion. Trump had purchased the pageant 17 years earlier, partnering with NBC. It was one of his most prized properties, bringing in millions of dollars a year in revenue, and perhaps as important, burnishing his image as an iconic international playboy celebrity. While in the Russian capital, Trump was also scouting for new and grand business opportunities, having spent decades trying, but failing, to develop high-end projects in Moscow. Miss Universe staffers considered it an open secret that Trump's true agenda in Moscow was not the show, but his desire to do business there. Yet, to those around him that afternoon, Trump seemed gripped by one question: where was Vladimir Putin? From the moment 5 months earlier when Trump announced Miss Universe would be staged that year in Moscow, he had seemed obsessed with the idea of meeting the Russian president. Do you think Putin will be going to the Miss Universe pageant in November in Moscow? If so, will he become my new best friend? Trump had tweeted in June. Once in Moscow, Trump received a private message from the Kremlin, delivered by Aras Agalarov, an oligarch close to Putin and Trump's partner in hosting the Miss Universe event in Moscow. Mr. Putin would like to meet Mr. Trump. That excited Trump. The American developer thought there was a strong chance the Russian leader would attend the pageant. But as his time in Russia wore on, Trump heard nothing else. He became uneasy. "Is Putin coming?" he kept asking. With no word from the Kremlin, it was starting to look grim. Then Agalarov conveyed a new message. Dmitry Peskov, Putin's right-hand man and press spokesman, would be calling any moment. Trump was relieved, especially after it was explained to him that few people were closer to Putin than Peskov. If anybody could facilitate a rendezvous with Putin, it was Peskov. "If you get a call from Peskov, it's like you're getting a call from Putin," Rob Goldstone, a British-born publicist who had helped bring the beauty contest to Moscow, told him. But time was running out. The show would be starting soon, and following the broadcast, Trump would be departing the city. Finally, Agalarov's cell phone rang. It was Peskov, and Agalarov handed the phone to an eager Trump. Trump's trip to Moscow for the Miss Universe contest was a pivotal moment. He had for years longed to develop a glittering Trump Tower in Moscow. With this visit, he would come near, so near, to striking that deal. He would be close to branding the Moscow skyline with his world-famous name and enhancing his own status as a sort of global oligarch. During his time in Russia, Trump would demonstrate his affinity for the nation's authoritarian leader with flattering and fawning tweets and remarks that were part of a long stretch of comments suggesting an admiration for Putin. Trump's curious statements about Putin before, during, and after this Moscow jaunt, would later confound U.S. intelligence officials, members of Congress, and Americans of various political inclinations, even Republican Party loyalists. What could possibly explain Trump's unwavering sympathy for the Russian strongman? His refusal to acknowledge Putin's repressive tactics, his whitewashing of Putin's abuses in Ukraine and Syria, his dismissal of the murders of Putin's critics, his blind eye to Putin's cyber attacks and disinformation campaigns aimed at subverting Western democracies. Trump's brief trip to Moscow held clues to this mystery. His 2 days there would later become much discussed because of allegations that he engaged in weird sexual antics while in Russia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.